ignorance, people thought God had created the world and every living thing, each with a purpose, in an ordered universe over which our Creator presided, rewarding good deeds and punishing sin. Charles Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection blew a hole in this comfortable explanation of life and faced us with a blindingly obvious yet disturbing truth. Humans don't have dominion over animals. We are animals. We're the fifth ape. But even Darwin hesitated to say this out loud. It throws into question our trust in our fellow human beings. Are our morals and manners just a veneer? Since a struggle for existence drives evolution, why don't we humans run an entirely dog-eat-dog world? How about genocide and ethnic cleansing? Are they some kind of survival strategy?
In this program, I want to confront the issue that Darwin skirted around in The Origin of Species, the evolution of human beings. I want to ask what it means for us to be evolved.
The question is more urgent than ever. Increasingly, religious people and others attack Darwinism for, in their view, excusing selfishness and barbarism. Throughout my career, I've wrestled with how to reconcile my liberal values with what Darwin revealed to be the pitiless war of nature. So now I'm going to take you into the Darwinian heart of darkness and look for answers and for hope.
Natural selection is the driving force of our evolution, but that doesn't mean that society ought to be run on Darwinian lines. As a scientist, I'm thrilled by natural selection, but as a human being, I abhor it as a principle for organizing society.
Evolution by natural selection is a very simple idea. Over thousands of generations, in a struggle for existence, successful variations have survived to reproduce, a process that gradually carves life into more and more specialized forms. Life forms that include the apes, gibbons, orangutans, gorillas, chimps, and us. Here at London Zoo, back in the 1830s, the arrival of the first apes outraged polite society. Queen Victoria, for one, found them painfully and disagreeably human. But another visitor was spellbound. The young Charles Darwin saw the unmistakable truth staring back at him from the other side of the cage. The uncanny familiarity of ape hands and the humanity we seem to glimpse in their eyes was for Darwin further evidence to support the idea of evolution, that all life was related. The African apes, he realized, were our closest evolutionary cousins. East Africa, my birthplace, and rather more importantly, the birthplace of the human species itself.
Between 5 and 6 million years ago, there lived in Africa an ape who had two children. One of those children was destined to give rise to us, and the other was destined to give rise to the chimpanzees. If I stood here and held my mother's hand, and she held her mother's hand, and she held her mother's hand, and so on back to the grand ancestor of all humans and all chimpanzees, how far would the line stretch? The answer is about 300 miles.
Over that surprisingly short distance, the fossil record shows evidence of extraordinary changes. The paleontologist Richard Leakey and his family have uncovered the hard evidence in Kenya's Rift Valley. Evidence that charts the evolution of our ancient human ancestors.
About 1.9 million years ago, you have skulls like this turning up now, and this is what they were calling Homo habilis. Largest brained, still got a flat big face, and probably ancestral to Homo erectus, which turns up in Africa at about 1.8 million years. This then is the ancestor to Homo sapiens. This persists for almost a million years, this condition, and then it gives way to something with an even larger brain, things that are much more like ourselves, these whopping great vaults. The brain has really expanded. It's much more like a modern human brain in terms of size and in terms of shape. And by the time you get to this, all of these others have disappeared from the fossil record. So there's all the major steps in the human story are in fact told in Africa.
I often meet people who say to me, nobody's going to tell me I'm an ape. Is there a kind of visceral revulsion, do you think? Do you meet that as well?
Yes, I do meet that, but it seems to be so misplaced because, as you know, we are the fifth ape and we never separated from the apes. We just do things differently. I've often found it fun to go to an ape exhibit in one of the big zoos and you can watch people looking at a group of chimpanzees. And what is very clear if you watch their facial expression, you can see that they're not so sure that apes like them, but they can look around and say, yeah, there's a similarity between the person on the other side of the cage. Yeah. We are closer to chimps, African chimps, than a horse is to an ass. Horses and asses put together produce offspring. Wow, says everybody. Are you? Yeah, I am.
It's an unsettling thought. In evolutionary terms, we're so closely related to chimps that it's not ridiculous to ask whether we might still be able to breed with them. We're the human animal, upright, big-brained ape cousins who evolved to outthink the competition. As a biologist, I've wondered at the challenging implications of this, what it tells us about human society now. But over half the people on Earth are so horrified by what Darwinism reveals about our origins, they just refuse to believe it.
I'm an ape.
Yeah.
Are you an ape?
No, I'm not. I'm a human being.
I'm on a journey exploring the dark side of Darwinism. I want to confront what it means for us to have evolved in nature's brutal struggle. Why should the fifth ape love thy neighbor? The thought of our animal origins can upset people. Read The Origin of Species, Darwin's masterpiece that set out his theory of evolution, and you will find only a handful of passing references to human origins. That man was made in God's image, having dominion over the animals, defined what it meant to be human. So, discussing human evolution was just too risky. Darwin shied away from it and simply wrote near the end, "Light will be thrown on the origin of man and his history." But when the book came to be published in 1859, the buzz was all about the extraordinary implications for mankind. Were we just beasts in fancy dress? Evolution became known as the monkey theory. The row has not gone away. In Kenya, the cradle of mankind, religious groups are trying to block the opening of the National Museum's exhibit of human fossils. The fossil record of human ancestry has a particular fascination. To me, these are far more precious than the crown jewels.
This is the Turkana Boy. Homo erectus, 1.5 million years old. The most complete ancient human skeleton ever found. It's one of the most precious relics in any museum, anywhere in the world. It would be an enormous pity if there were any pressure not to allow it to be seen.
The 10 million strong evangelical movement in Kenya has run a hide the bones campaign. By coincidence, I was born right next door to the church where the protest is being led by Bishop Bonifes Adoyo.
Bishop, how do you do? Very nice of you to agree to this meeting.
Same here, to meet the great professor.
Oh, let's go into it. You know, I was born just over the road there.
No, I'm told over the other side.
Well, we'll have to work that out later.
You've met your...
It was clear that we weren't going to see eye to eye from the beginning.
I'm an ape.
Yeah.
Are you, Bishop?
I'm not. Okay. Definitely I'm not. Okay. I'm special. Made in the image of God, in the creative mind of God, creative as God is, who made me. That's the difference between the ape and me.
Well, I'm an ape. I'm an African ape. Yeah. And I'm very proud to be an African ape.
Yeah.
And so should you be. Don't you think the evidence should be displayed for all to see and make up their own minds?
Yeah, sure. Everybody,
but you're against display.
Everybody should make up their own mind. No, I'm not against the display. I'm against the attachment of the evolution theory to the displays. You see, that's all we're talking about.
So you'd be happy for them to be displayed, but not with evolutionary and be told, messages.
Because they are complete human being skulls.
Well, not really. I mean, they're very much smaller than ours, and they've got very much less brain. The 3-million-year-old one have the same size brain as chimpanzees. They were kind of chimpanzees on their hind legs. Mm-hmm. So it was a first step towards becoming human. And the next step was then, in the Turkana Boy, to have a bigger brain. Mm-hmm. And the final step was to have an even bigger brain like us.
If that's where we originated and evolved into this stage, why aren't those chimpanzees also evolving into man? Why aren't they extinct? Because by the time we developed to this level, they should have been extinct.
No, that's not the way evolution works. We're not descended from them.
Yes.
We're cousins of them. So we and they go back to a common ancestor. There are the chimpanzees, there's us. We go back to a common ancestor. Now, that common ancestor was not a chimpanzee and it was not a human. It was something else. And it evolved towards being a chimpanzee.
Yeah.
In a different direction, it evolved towards being a human. So chimpanzees have been evolving all that time, and humans have been evolving all that time.
Okay.
And they'll probably both go on evolving, but we can't predict where that will go.
Mm-hmm. Our discussion now threw up an important point about evolution.
So what is the goal of evolution? What is the ultimate goal? Is it for us to have big heads?
No, there is no goal.
There's no goal?
It just happens.
That doesn't answer my question. Where are we heading to? I mean, up to where shall we say that this is the limit of evolution?
It doesn't have goals. It's a misunderstanding of evolution to say it has goals. It never did have goals.
Yeah.
It just changes.
This is crucial. To understand evolution by natural selection, you have to grasp that it is not a grand scheme with goals. It's a harsh, unguided process, which simply favors those that are most successful at passing on their genes. It has no morality or purpose. And we humans are just one of its products. Darwin took man off his pedestal and made him an animal like all others. We evolved in the ruthless competition of nature. So, what does that mean for us and our society? To begin to grapple with this problem, we have to understand what nature is in all its brutal glory.
It looks like nature in harmony. Actually, as Darwin realized, there's a struggle out there. All the players are working for their own benefit, and because they're surrounded by others who are working for their own benefit, they tend to exploit each other. In the shady forest, all the plants are struggling to get to the light. Big trees pay the price legitimately by growing up to the sun. But this strangler fig does a very strange and cruel thing. It started life high up in the tree from a seed, perhaps dropped by a fruit-eating monkey. It then sent roots down towards the ground in order to get nourishment from the ground. And then these roots proliferate all around the original tree and strangle it to death. Eventually, the original tree will die and the fig will be left standing on its own, having usurped its position in the sun. The bitter struggle for survival in nature has been the dynamic force that has driven the evolution of life. And with the consequences of Darwinism begins. Attacks on Darwin have claimed that his goalless, soulless theory has unleashed the worst of human nature. If nature is ruthless competition, and nature is where we evolved, then is this the model for human society, every man for himself? Well, let's look at this. There is one area of human affairs in which the dog-eat-dog mentality is natural. In business. Certain elements of business have always loved what they perceive as Darwin's message. The strong must survive, the weak perish. Here is apparent justification for unrestrained capitalism and denying help to the poor. Several of the great entrepreneurs of the early 20th century, the so-called robber barons like the oil tycoon John D. Rockefeller, were unashamed social Darwinists. They believed human progress would be delivered by modeling business and society on nature, on the unceasing struggle of the jungle.
Today, the giants of the oil industry stand as monuments to Rockefeller, the architect of our business age.
Social Darwinism is still with us. In the 1990s, the American energy company Enron ran a kind of nasty Darwinian experiment, lining up 15% of the least fit of their workforce to be fired each year. It didn't end well. Enron selected not necessarily the best, but the most ruthless individuals, who turned a blind eye to the widespread fraud that brought the company down in scandal.
Kent Lang, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer, Enron.
I've come to a convention of entrepreneurs in London to observe today's business animal up close.
My best friend is a money broker in the city and has more money and knows what to do with, and he's offered me whatever I need.
Okay, one thing's confusing me, and that is why you're here.
Mark, good presentation. I suppose I should put my cards on the table. I don't like the recruitment industry generally.
For a very long time, people have noticed the similarities between economic systems and biological systems, and particularly the notion of competition in both systems. When businesses compete, we can think of them as designs. So you might have a design for a bank, a way to run a bank. And each of the banks along the high street will have a slightly different way of running a bank, a different design. And the evolutionary competition is it's a competition for you walking down the high street to determine which bank will serve you best, which design suits your needs better than the others.
So are we looking at corporate apes fighting for supremacy without compassion, teeth bared? I wonder if it's more posturing than reality.
Do you think there's a risk of overdoing the Darwinian analogy?
Yes, very much so. The press loves to play up company CEOs and entrepreneurs as these heroes, and in many ways they are. They work incredibly hard, make great sacrifices. But the myth is that they were these great visionaries, these people who could predict the future and drive an organization toward that future. The reality is economic systems, just like biological systems, are hugely complex. And being able to predict what's going to happen in the long term is extraordinarily difficult or even impossible. And what some companies do is, rather than try to outguess where the market is going, they'll create some notion of variety within their company and then let the market choose, let customers decide which products and services they like best.
Now, these legendary moguls who emerge, I mean, is it sort of luck that they're the ones who just, they just happen to get it right, and with hindsight you can say that they got it right, but that's all, it's just hindsight.
Well, not to take away from the talent that these individuals may have, but if you imagine a room full of people flipping coins, if the room's big enough, one of them is going to get 10 heads in a row. And then if you ask that person, what did you do? They'll say, well, I'm an expert coin flipper, I got my wrist just right. And we see the same thing in business.
So, Darwinism in business seems to be little more than a metaphor, an analogy. It certainly doesn't provide a straightforward natural law for economic progress, as social Darwinists used to argue. But can Darwinism be applied to other areas of human affairs? What about taking back the reins of our own evolution? Don't copy nature, but control it. Speed up the elimination process.
Once they have been born, defectives are happier and more useful in these institutions than when at large. But it would have been better by far if they had never been born.
It's been tried before. The eugenics movement of the early 20th century aimed to stop the weak procreating through compulsory sterilization of the unfit.
Eugenics seeks to apply the known laws of heredity so as to prevent the degeneration of the race and improve its inborn qualities.
Here was a slippery slope down to a nightmare. At its worst, eugenics became a dark tribal vision, ultimately used to justify ethnic genocide in Nazi Germany, with horrific echoes in Bosnia and Rwanda. I feel strongly that the barbarism that was the culmination of eugenics in the 20th century was atrocious. But it's important to say eugenics is not Darwinism. Eugenics is not a version of natural selection. Hitler, despite popular legend, was not a Darwinist. Every farmer, horticulturalist, or pigeon fancier knew how to breed for desired outcomes. Eugenicists like Hitler borrowed from breeders. What Darwin uniquely realized was that nature can play the role of breeder. Darwin has been wrongly tainted. I've always hated how Darwin is wheeled out to justify cutthroat business competition, racism, and right-wing politics. And throughout my career, I've grappled with the apparent paradox of the way cooperation, being nice to each other, even morality, could evolve from the mindless brutality of nature. Charles Darwin argued in Origin of Species that evolution of life on Earth had been driven by a brutal struggle for existence. Natural selection can seem bleak for many biologists. Certainly, nature can be pitiless and cruel. But I've been intrigued by what appear to be acts of kindness in nature. Warning cries, huddling for warmth and comfort, and mutual grooming. Animals like these are displaying what we call altruism. They're giving something to another at a cost to themselves. The question I've grappled with as a biologist is why? The explanation must at some point involve the brain. Altruism, like any other behavior, must have evolved over time as brains have evolved. So now, I want to talk to somebody who knows about our evolved psychology.
Steve, hello, and nice to see you.
When we teach about evolution, we naturally tend to focus on anatomy. But you could equally well say that psychology, that our minds are evolved organs or organ systems, couldn't you?
Well, yes, and we have every reason to believe that the mind is a product of the activity of the brain, and I happen to have one here. And it's clear that the brain is an organ. It's got an evolutionary history. All of the parts in the human brain you can find in the brain of chimpanzee and other mammals. And we also know that the brain is not just a random neural network. And we have reason to believe that a lot of the products of the brain, our perception, our emotions, our language, our ways of thinking, are strategies for negotiating the world, surviving, bringing up children, finding mates, negotiating relationships.
I suppose we can all understand why sexual lust has Darwinian survival value. And are you now saying that the mechanisms for guilt, trust, that those are a bit like lusts? I mean, there's a lust to trust, or is that
Indeed. I mean, yeah. There are, and people have no problem accepting Darwinian explanations for emotions that are triggered by the physical world. Fear of heights and snakes and spiders and the dark and deep water. Disgust at bodily secretions that might be carrying parasites or rotting meat and so on. Often feel a little more surprised and even resistant to the idea that some of our moral emotions might have an evolutionary basis, like trust, like sympathy, like gratitude. But I think that as clear as it is that fear has an evolutionary basis, I think our moral emotions can be analyzed in the same way.
I think Steven Pinker is right and that we do have an evolved morality. But I also understand why there is resistance to the idea. Why would the genes for the parts of the brain that involve giving at a cost to oneself be inherited in nature's brutal struggle for existence? To explore this, I want to look at another case where individual survival doesn't appear to be the priority. A peacock's plumage is gorgeous, but it must get in the way of its own survival. It's easily spotted by predators, and its huge weight must hinder a quick escape. So, why isn't the peacock's tail eliminated by natural selection? Charles Darwin was puzzled. "The sight of a feather in a peacock's tail, whenever I gaze at it," he wrote, "makes me sick." But it was Darwin himself who hit upon the answer: sex. The peacock's tail is a burden to himself, but a boon to the genes that built it. Why? Because the tail wins sexual partners. Something about the peahen's brain is attracted to bright feathers and extravagant, maybe costly, advertisement. Peacock evolution has been shaped not just by individual survival, but by peahen brains. Peahens, in effect, selectively breed peacocks, as pigeon fanciers breed pigeons. Darwin defined this as sexual selection. Evolution, he now realized, wasn't just about which animals survived, but which could prevail in winning the favors of the opposite sex.
There are two ways for an individual to pass its genes on to the next generation. You've got to survive, and you may have to be attractive to the opposite sex. A peacock is a walking advertising hoarding. A peacock's tail, with its eye spots, is like a walking neon sign.
Here in America, I'm looking into an unexpected way in which women could be said to be practicing a form of selective breeding. I'm going to meet some single women who, in the cold light of day, are choosing the attributes they want to mate with and hope to pass on to their children. Is it even possible that kindness, altruism, is one of the things they go for?
Hi.
Hello, you must be Stacy.
Yes, I am. Welcome.
I'm Richard.
Very nice to meet you. Come in.
And this is...
These women want to become mothers through a sperm donor. It's a kind of high-tech sexual selection.
Did you think you were choosing a man that you yourself
might
have been attracted to?
Absolutely. Yes. I mean, it's a little bit, I joke, it's a little bit like going on Match.com. You pay for a three-month membership and you look at the photos. And, you know, I know some women that look at it that way. You know, you're looking for healthy, attractive, fit and intelligent. So I would want those qualities for my child, the same qualities I would want in a partner.
Right.
They're appealing for people in general.
Yes.
At least that's how I look at it.
For the women's potential partners, partners whom they never meet, the process begins here.
Down here we have the donor rooms, where, you know, they can do their thing. And, you know, we're trying to...
Suitable pictures on the wall.
Oh, of course, you've got to have a little inspirational material to help it along, you know.
But who are the women going to pick?
It's the same type of room.
Are there any women who say, well, just give me something at random?
Very, very, very rarely.
Okay.
Tell me a woman that has walked into a shoe shop and said, just give me whatever you have. That doesn't happen, you know.
No, that's right. Yeah. I mean, I'm
anything
interested
you buy,
because...
you spend time on your
that's
decision.
That's right, of course. But, yeah. I mean, we kind of in our society pay lip service to the idea that there's something taboo about eugenic choice.
Yeah.
And so you might think that the women might, as it were, go along with that and say, well, no, I don't approve of eugenics, so I don't...
It's America. It's a society of contemplation and consumerism. People are used to, you go online, you buy products, you ask questions about the products.
Donors have to provide full and intimate details of all aspects of their life.
Shoe size and allergies and skin tone, if he tans easily.
There's one that caught my eye. 6'1", hazel eyes, curly brown hair.
Favorite pet dog?
Favorite pet. If he's a smoker.
Likes James Bond.
He likes the Aston Martin. He likes jazz music.
But I want to return to the enigma of altruism. Is it possible that among the qualities women want in a sperm donor is niceness, kindness?
I'm interested in this donor because he explained that someone in his family had difficulty getting pregnant, and so it was important to him to be able to help others who were in need of assistance in that area. So I like that.
What's fascinating is that the women don't just want the obvious alpha male qualities.
You know, there's so many things that goes into it than just looks and or intelligence. One of the donors that have been really popular is actually the nicest guy.
And
I don't know how you put that in a formal, but he's the nicest guy.
Yes.
He's not the smartest guy.
Yeah.
He's not the best looking guy.
So how do they know he's the nicest guy?
Well, he's actually written a really good extended profile about himself.
So
I've actually met the guy. Mm. That I can tell you the profile actually checks out. He is a really nice guy.
So what's going on here at a more fundamental level? This goes back to an old interest of mine. I became fascinated by the issue of how animals evolved to be nice when I started teaching biology at Oxford in the 1960s. This was barely 10 years after the structure of DNA in genes had first been cracked by Watson and Crick. And I was intrigued how the new science of genetics could help provide an answer to the puzzle of altruism. Genes are coded instructions that build every living thing, body and mind. They give rise to the distinctive family nose down through the generations. They dictate what color eyes you have. But such examples are just the outward and visible tip of the iceberg. Now here's the point. We organisms, you, me, an octopus, a forget-me-not, or a giraffe, are survival machines. We're vehicles for the genes that ride inside us, vehicles that are thrown away after we've handed the precious coded information on to the next generation through reproduction. Genes are copied from one generation to the next, on and on. So they, and they alone, are immortal. I advocate a kind of gene's eye view of nature. The genes that survive are the ones that consistently provide slightly longer necks, slightly keener eyes, or improve camouflage, and so help their vehicle to survive, and therefore pass those same genes on. The survival of the fittest really means the survival of genes, because it is only genes that really survive down through many generations. A gene that didn't look after its own interests would not survive. That's the meaning of the phrase, selfish gene. Okay, so how can selfish genes support kindness? If genes are striving selfishly to make more copies of themselves, how can a gene achieve this selfish objective by making its bearer behave altruistically? One part of the answer is kinship. An altruistic gene can spread through the population so long as the altruism is directed at other organisms that have the same gene. In other words, at family. So, selfish genes build parent animals who protect their young. In human terms, parents who'd rush into a burning building to save their children. This is called kin selection. The other part of the answer is reciprocal altruism. You scratch my back and I'll scratch yours. When animals live in groups where they encounter each other repeatedly, genes for returning favors can survive. Individuals sacrifice themselves for each other. They give food to each other, to close kin, and to other individuals who might be in a position to pay back favors on another occasion. Selfish genes give rise to altruistic individuals. In the 70s, I wrote a book bringing these ideas together called The Selfish Gene. The idea that altruism ultimately boils down to a survival game for genes raised hackles, but it's now widely accepted among biologists. But it's not the end of the story. I realized there really does seem to be something odd about humans. Aren't humans rather nicer than even the theory of the selfish gene would expect? We donate to charity, give blood, weep in sympathy at the plight of complete strangers. Now, I want to explore why. I've been struggling all my life with why people should be quite so kind and decent to each other. At first glance, it seems to go against the dog-eat-dog viciousness of Darwinism. To be sure, Darwinism was softened because it was in the selfish interests of genes to build altruistic animals. There are good genetic reasons for limited acts of kindness. But I can't help wondering, is this enough to explain the kindness of humans? Or even chimpanzees. The Dutch primatologist Frans de Waal has been a critic of the selfish gene idea. He studies chimps. He believes that our closest living relatives exhibit empathy and moral concern that goes beyond the kin altruism and tit-for-tat of selfish genes.
Let's say there's a big fight, someone loses the fight. Very often another one will go over to them, put an arm around them, try to calm them down, groom them. We call that consolation behavior, and actually that's common enough that you can collect data on it.
De Waal has accused my work of promoting what he's labeled veneer theory. The idea that morals are a thin veneer on top of the inherent nastiness of our animal nature.
Yeah, well, I think the reason I speak of veneer theory is because we've seen like 30 years of books published on how humans are not inherently kind, humans are deep down nasty, and if we are kind, it's only to make a good impression on each other, and if we are moral, it's just a little veneer over human nature. Yes. And I take opposition to that.
My feeling is that the phenomena that we see, which you've described as empathetic, are phenomena which need explaining, mm-hmm. and we're going to explain them, in my case, we're going to explain them in terms of selfish genes. Selfish genes are just as good at explaining altruistic behavior as they are at explaining selfish behavior.
But maybe the problem is that it is certainly a self-promoting gene, and so the word selfies has a motivational content, of course, and I think that's where people sometimes get confused between, if we have selfish genes, that means that we must be selfies, and that. And those things need to be kept apart.
Well, they really do. I mean, it's a very unfortunate confusion, because most of the book is about altruistic behavior.
Yeah. You know that in political ideology, it has also been used. So, for example, what we call social Darwinism, which is very prominent in this country, in the US, is a sort of ideological streak which says, well, animals are not nice to each other. We humans should not be nice to each other. There's no reason, for example, to help the poor.
Yeah.
Because the poor need to help themselves, and if they cannot do that, then they perish, and that's fine, too.
I hate social Darwinism, too. But that doesn't mean we should romanticize nature or not face facts when it comes to the genetic roots of altruism. I think altruism has been favored by kin selection in small groups in nature. But when it comes to humans, something special is going on. We've gone beyond kin selection. Our world now has been scaled up. We live amongst large, anonymous populations of strangers, not kin who share our genes, and not people who we might expect to return favors. And yet we still have a lust to be nice.
The rule that's built into your brain says, be nice to everyone you meet. Mm-hmm. And that works in nature, because everyone you meet is going to be part of the small group. Similarly, everyone you meet is actually probably going to be a cousin. So when I see another human being in distress, weeping or something like that, I have an almost uncontrollable urge to go and console, to maybe, you know, put my arm around them. What's the matter? How can I help? Please let me help you. And that's a strong inner urge, which as a Darwinian, I believe has ancestral roots in a past when I lived in small groups like this, small bands, in which I was likely to be surrounded by kin or surrounded by individuals who could reciprocate. I no longer am. This person who is weeping is a complete stranger to me. They will never reciprocate, and yet the lust is still there. I can't help it.
She lost it.
She got it last time.
I got another one. Keep her.
Oh, brilliant.
Why are humans often so good to complete strangers? Could it be because our selfish genes are, in some sense, a blessed sense, misfiring? Compare it to sexual desire. The lust to copulate, even though we deliberately use contraception to thwart its evolutionary purpose, is still there because of hard wiring from the genes. Similarly, we have a lust, even to total strangers, because niceness has been hardwired into us from the time when we used to live in small groups of close kin and close acquaintances with whom it would pay to reciprocate favors. This, for me, is the antidote to the darkness some have seen in our Darwinian heritage. And it goes further. The joy of being conscious human beings is that we rise above our origins. Our misfiring selfish genes mean we don't ape the nastiness of nature, but extract ourselves from it and live by our values. As Darwin recognized, we humans are the first and only species able to escape the brutal force that created us, natural selection. We civilized men do our utmost to check the process of elimination. We build asylums for the imbecile, the maimed, and the sick. We institute poor laws, and our medical men exert their utmost skill to save the life of every one to the last moment. This is the 999 Club in London's East End. It takes in the less fortunate, alcoholics, drug addicts and the homeless, providing them with tea and hot meals. Such altruism is, I believe, among the pinnacles of human civilization. We care for the most vulnerable in our society. We look after the sick. We give welfare to the needy.
Because I feel, which I've always felt, that they need something hot to warm them up. You know, when they've been out all night sleeping and they've got no warmth in their bodies, now you think, if we only have a cup of soup.
And what makes you feel the need to be so nice and so good?
Well, I was a war child, so we never had a lot of food, and that's why I've always try to look after these best I can, you know, and I think, well, if they're hungry, I'll feed them.
So you felt hungry as a child, so yes. You felt, I don't want that to happen to other people.
No, that's it. That's yes. How I felt.
We can empathise. We can imagine how it is for others. A society run on crude Darwinian lines would be a ruthless, merciless place. Fortunately, natural selection gave us big brains. With those big brains, we can plan a gentler society, the sort of society in which we would want to live. Evolution has no purpose. There's no benevolence there, no forward planning. Some people find that disturbing, but there is a better way to think about it. We, alone on Earth, have evolved to the extraordinary point where we can understand the selfish genes that shaped us. They are not models for how to behave, but the opposite. Because we are conscious of these forces, we can work towards taming them. Through kindness and morality, modern medicine, charity, even paying our taxes, we can overthrow the tyranny of natural selection. Our evolved brains empower us to rebel against our selfish genes. Next time, Into the Lion's Den, today's religious backlash against Darwin. The ever more elaborate strategies to deny the evidence of evolution, and how Darwin himself struggled with the implications of his own theory.
See exclusive videos of Dawkins on Darwin and discover more about the